20 pack in a black bag. 100 grand in my backpack. Yeah, we get real trap money, fuck a rap check, dog. I don't ever wanna be broke again. I take two big puffs and I hold it in. I'm gonna go to Gay Bridge on my way to Moran. I've been in the game.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of HomeGrown Hustlers. It's just gonna be on me on a solo run today. Cody's off with some business endeavors, so here we are. And you know, today we're gonna stay away from the political nuances and the, you know, all the madness going on in the world. And we're just gonna do what the listeners have been requesting, which is, you know, start to answer some of the questions that have been sent in from the different listeners at different times. So today, you know, our wonderful cameraman Jorge, he's gonna ask me some questions off in the background, and I'll do my best to answer. So I hope you guys enjoy.
Yeah. So question one: what was your biggest mess up on your way to your first million?
Wow. Okay. Well, I had a lot of mess ups. it's a laundry list of mess ups. And, you know, everyone that's listening, it doesn't matter how many times you mess up, it only takes one time of succeeding to wipe away all of those mess ups, if you will. I have a lot. I should have started earlier. You know, I should have got out of Montana at an earlier age. I should have gathered mentors earlier. But, like, specifically, I'll think of one. Early in my cannabis career, probably late 2009, we had a very, robust cannabis operation in Montana. And, we had a large flower room that was about 6 weeks into flower. And I showed up at the facility and I said, all right, everything looks great. Da, 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 da. I said, where's the CO2 levels at? And, you know, the people in the facility said, oh, the CO2's off. We're not utilizing it right now for one reason or another. And I said, absolutely not. Not happening. Get the CO2 on now. You know, we have to increase yields as much as possible. So we fired up the CO2 burners in Montana. You can use CO2 burners because it's, you know, it's relatively cold overall. And CO2 burners went to work. And in 3 days, I killed the entire room. It was probably... it was over $1 million in cannabis, for sure. And I was losing my mind, couldn't sleep, you know, had specialists come take a look to see if they could figure out what was going on. And no one could figure it out. But what ended up happening is the CO2 is heavier than air, so it started to sink down to the bottom. I was growing in these very large troughs, if you will, probably... you know, 150 galloners, thinking that if the roots had more room to spread out, that the plants would be bigger yields, so on and so forth. And I didn't have any mechanism to drain water or anything out of those troughs. And so when the CO2 was coming down, it was much heavier than the air. It sat in those troughs and had nowhere to go. Well, the root system of a plant takes oxygen, and then the canopy of the plant takes CO2. Well, the CO2 essentially sat in those root zones and suffocated every single plant in there and killed off the entire room. And I was in a place when I definitely could not afford a loss like that. So it was crushing, to say the least. And, you know, a lot of people start giving up, and but you know, negativity starts to surround you and you start asking yourself why and if this is worth it and everything else. But, you know, all I can tell you guys is keep pushing and be persistent, and eventually you'll break through. And, you know, you get to look back and say, wow, that was a great journey, and now look at me. You know, I'm in a position of success, and I'm able to enjoy life to its fullest extent. So, that's it.
Question two: explain burn rate and how much money it takes to make more money. Scalability of the burn rate.
Okay, so a burn rate essentially is how much money you're burning in a set amount of time. So normally you go monthly. It can also be known as your expenses. What's your monthly expenses for your company, for personal? You can really apply it to anything that has a cash flow attached to it. So let's stick with company burn rates because that's normally where it's used. Company's burn rate is, you know, how much money you're spending on a monthly basis. And then your revenue and profitability goes against your expenses, and whatever's left over, whether it's a negative amount or a positive amount, that's either going to be your profit or your loss. And so that's how you kind of justify the health and, you know, the health of your company and growth factors and a lot of different things. And normally you do that in a weekly, monthly, quarterly, biannual, or annual basis. All of them have different applications, and they come in useful for different things. Let's say, all right, the next part of the question is how much money does it take to make more money? Well, if your burn rate is $5 a month and your revenue is $10 a month, that means that you're making $5 at the end of each month. Well, you can then, instead of taking that $5 that you've made and putting in your pocket, you can essentially reinvest that $5 into your company to continue its growth pattern. And that's called recycling your cash flow, which is basically just pumping your money back through your company in order to create more growth. So if you took that $5 and reapplied into your company, maybe the next month you make $15. But your expenses relatively stay the same, so they're still $5. So month two, if you made $15 and your expenses were $5 or your burn rate was $5, then you dropped $10 down to the bottom, or profit of $10. You can either take that money and put it in your pocket, or take that money and reinvest it in your company for more growth. Anyone with half a brain would hopefully reinvest in their company and try to get the company's growth to the, you know, most exponential point that it can be at. And it's really like a snowball effect, right? So I don't know if, you know, all of you guys have ever been in a winter. We are in Arizona here, but I grew up in Montana, so it's a good analogy from where I'm from. You take a snowball and you build it, you know, maybe you're going to throw it at someone, hit a stop sign, who knows. But it's a small snowball like the size of a baseball or a softball. Well, if you take that same snowball and you go up to a big hill and you roll that snowball down the hill, eventually it's going to pick up momentum, speed, size, to the point of where it can start taking houses out. And that's the same type of thing with business. The snowball keeps rolling and builds up this momentum, and it's picking up more and more snow. Well, that's the same thing with cash flow. As you get more and more momentum, you're recycling more and more cash flow, and each month you're exponentially growing and seeing bigger results until you have something of serious size that's worth, you know, $5 million, $10 million, $50 million, $500 million, $2 billion, depending on what business you're in and how much cash you're generating, how much you're putting it back into your company. So it doesn't. There's no set amount of money it takes to make more money. It's all about recycling the profitability of your company back into your company to get it to grow more. That's how you take money to make money. Now, the other option is, let's say you have a company that's doing $100,000 in revenue a month. Your burn rate or your expenses are $50,000 a month. So you're dropping $50,000 to the bottom line, or $50,000 in profit. Now, let's say that you're happy with that company and you feel like there's not a lot of more growth potential in that specific market that you're occupying. So you might take that $50,000 a month and you might go start accumulating that money each month until you have enough money to, say, put that down on a down payment for an apartment complex. So now you have another asset that's revenue producing, because if you do it right, then the apartment complex will cash flow each month. And hopefully you're reinvesting that cash flow back in the apartment complex to pay it off faster. But now you have a cash flowing business that was doing $50,000 a month, and now you're buying and paying off an apartment complex by utilizing the profit from that company. And you can continue doing this with more and more companies if you want diversification, or you can keep investing it into your initial company to have exponential growth there. Diversification is key, but at the same time, you know, the guys that I know that have made the most money in their lifetimes have always had laser focus on one deal, growing it up to the largest size that they possibly can, and then taking some of that money and diversifying into other things once they're in a place of extreme comfortability from a financial standpoint. So hopefully that answered your question. And if you want me to get more granular, please just reach out on the podcast and I'll dive even deeper.
Question three, when was the first time you identified your story with someone who was further along or on the same path? Did you consider them a mentor or a competition?
Early on, my first real entrepreneurial endeavor where, you know, I really got aggressive was real estate. Started when I was 20 and figured out very quickly that I didn't have the secret playbook. I didn't know what I was doing. I saw these guys that were 5-10 years older than me that were essentially killing it, you know, in those terms back then. You know, these guys were making $300,000-$500,000 a year, which seemed like, you know, that seemed like hundreds of millions of dollars to me at the time. So I found this gentleman in Montana that was doing very well. He was, you know, making well into six figures, and he was probably about 8 years older than me. He took me under his wing, and, you know, he was a great mentor, coach, helped me as much as he could, extremely nice gentleman. And, you know, I'll always be thankful for that. I would say that, he never really ended up as competition just because we kind of, there was enough market for us to go around. And he was really the one that showed me how important it was to have mentors. Now, if you fast forward into cannabis, I've primarily, anyone I've had as a mentor has normally been older, 60s, 70s. Just, I like guys that have a ton of life experience, have been around the block. And normally how this would go is you would have a mentor and eventually they would become competition. And if you're really good, then sometimes student becomes teacher. But in this specific environment, I still have the same mentor as I did 10 years ago. I'm very loyal. I'm very faithful to people. If they've helped me get to another level or achieve things that I wouldn't have been able to achieve on my own, I never, you know, cut them off or push them out of the circle. I keep a very close circle. Loyalty is more important to me than anything. And so I try to keep the same people around for long periods of time. I don't like to turn and burn human beings. And so, yeah, normally I would say a mentor does end up becoming a competitor. Just that's the natural progression of business and life. But in my circumstance, my mentors were older and they were not in their prime fighting years. So they never became my competitors. I would say our conversations have changed a lot in the last 10 years. From me being a sponge and absorbing everything I could from them and, you know, loving every word that came out of their mouth to now, you know, I come up with my own ideas. And, you know, I always bring them along on the ride because, like I said, I'm a loyal person. But for the most part, yeah, definitely not the competition. And now our engagements are different because I'm so much farther along than I was 10 years ago. So it's more of peer-to-peer versus mentor to mentee. And now sometimes they ask me for advice or, you know, what my thoughts are on these business deals versus here's how it is. Now it's more collaborative and we bounce ideas off each other and things like that. But I'm, you know, I can't explain how thankful I am to have the group of advisors and mentors that I do in my life, because without those people, I would never be where I'm at today.
Question 4, if you had to put a dollar per hour rate, or how much would you like to be netting per hour? What is your main goal?
So I think that question is a loaded question. I don't look at anything in an hourly format ever. I think that's a very blue collar mentality, because you see people saying, well, I only make $14 an hour. I want to make $17 an hour. Or, you know, I only make $22 an hour. I need that next raise to get $25 an hour. You'll never get ahead with that mentality, ever. So I look at things like, all right, if I look at this opportunity, and right now it's just an idea, what can I grow that opportunity to in 24 months, 36 months, 48 months? And what skills will I acquire by pursuing this endeavor? So I would look at, I don't look at hourly pay ever. That's a horrible thing to do. I look at what I can make a company into from a value standpoint, and then what the exit looks like. So, you know, if I think that I can get involved in something and in 4 years I can make the company worth $800 million or $1.3 billion or whatever it may be, and then I figure out what my piece of that pie would be on that exit, and then I reverse engineer and decide if that's the most appropriate use of my time. I'm 35 years old, and so I'm definitely in my peak income earning potential as of now. So I have to be very selective about what deals I will or won't do, because, you know, if you blink, you know, 10 years will pass you by at this point. So I think it's a, you know, I think it's a game of risk assessment, what you think's most important from a skill acquiring perspective, what skills are you going to gain by doing so? And then in 3-4 years, who cares about how much money you're going to make from now till then? It's on that exit, how much money you're going to make. Is your goal 8 figures? So 10 million plus? Is your goal 9 figures, 100 million plus? Is it 10 figures, which is a billion plus? Is it 7 figures, which is a million plus? You know, so you just have to figure out what your own personal goal is. And you start at the end. All right, I want to make $1 million within the next 4 years. All right, so start putting a plan together today of how you want to make $1 million in the next 48 months. And so you start at the end of $1 million and you reverse engineer your plan all the way back to where you're at today. That's how you figure out how to hit your goals. And I think people I think people are overly optimistic about how much they can get done in a month or a quarter or a year. And I think people underestimate what they can get done in a decade. You know, 10 years ago, I was making $3,000 a month. And, you know, I had big dreams and aspirations, but, you know, I had to put a plan in place to try and achieve those things. And so with a lot of hard work and a little bit of luck, you know, you can basically achieve anything you want. And I feel like I'm kind of living proof of that. So,
yeah, another good business question here. You know, been speaking on the whole, you know, term rate of success. Do you think it's really necessary? You hear about people going through struggles, you know, grinding for 10 years, not making a single cent before they make it, you know, quote unquote big. Do you think that's really necessary, or everyone kind of has to go through that before they get their first taste of success?
No. I think, you know, every story is unique. I think everyone is different. I know people that have jumped into business, got extremely lucky, you know, in the right place, right time, and made $50 million on their first try ever, you know, within 18 months of being an entrepreneur. I know other entrepreneurs who have been entrepreneurs for 25, 30 years and have made a living, but, you know, have never had a big score. And, you know, just to be completely transparent and honest, this isn't for everybody. You know, I think a lot of people look at social media and they see the glitz and the glam of what it's like to be an entrepreneur with the, you know, the lifestyle, the traveling, the exotic locations, the fast cars, the hot girls. I think they see all that stuff, but, you know, do they see, you know, when you're early on and you're broke and you're frustrated and you're confused and you're crying, you know, yourself to sleep, or, you know, you're deciding if you're going to pay your power bill or buy your month's worth of Top Ramen. And to be honest, most people just don't have the stomach for it. And, you know, that's why most people are employees or workers and not business owners or, you know, entrepreneurs. You have to have an extremely high risk tolerance. You have to be extremely persistent. You have to be willing to, you know, get punched in the face a lot, not physically, but, you know, theoretically, because you're going to fail. Odds are you're going to fail many, many times before you get that big success. But if I went to a guy right now that busted his butt for 14 years and didn't make much money from 0 to 14 years, and then on the 14th year, he exited his company for $128 million. And I go to that guy and I say, hey, would you do that again for 14 years to get to that pivotal moment when you exited for nine figures? Every single one of them say, absolutely, I'd do it 10 times again. Because the reward is so great and the feeling of euphoria is so amazing when you finally get to the top of the mountain. And that's not even talking about now you're going to have a life of ease, right? You can do what you want. No one can ever tell you what to do again. You can go travel for the rest of your life. Do whatever you want. All of them are going to tell you that 14-year commitment of chipping your teeth on the concrete, is one way they call it, was worth that, you know, that nine-figure exit. So, you know, I had a lot of failures, a ton. And I was only mildly successful until I found the right mentors and advisors. It just finally all clicked. And, you know, I didn't even know exactly. I didn't have a concrete plan in place. I didn't have everything figured out. I didn't have the recipe book. I just kept looking, and I kept failing. And I didn't know what was right. I didn't know what was wrong. But I felt something deep inside of me was telling me I was on the right track, and I was heading in the right direction. Financially, was I in that position financially? No, I was broke. Did I feel like I was making a lot of progress? No, I felt defeated, and I felt like I wanted to quit. I can't even tell you guys how many times I had Costco and Home Depot applications pulled up on my laptop, and I was just like, fuck this. Like, I can't do it anymore. Like, I can't keep wondering where the next money's coming in. I can't keep living like this. I've destroyed so many of my relationships that I valued so much. And so, yeah, there was so many times when I just wanted to throw in the towel and just go live a normal life. And, you know, fast forward now, no. I'm glad I stuck with it, obviously. You know, it all worked out for the best. But you have to trust your gut, and you have to go with your instinct, and you just have to hope and pray that it's all going to work out. And, you know, the world has a very mysterious way of working itself out. I've found that the harder you work, the luckier you get. Go figure, right? So, back to the question. There's not some set playbook of how this works out. I've seen guys make their first $50 million in the first year, I've seen guys do it for 25, 30 years that have never made, you know, more than 50,000 a year. So I think there's a lot of it comes into play as your personality. How willing are you to go out of your comfort zone on a daily basis? What are you willing to do to be successful? Are you willing to do what no one else is willing to do? Because that's kind of what it takes. You have, essentially in business, what you have is the best and the brightest, most aggressive minds in the world fighting for the same thing, these pieces of paper we call money. And so you're in the most competitive environment in the world. Everybody is going for the same thing. It's money. And I love it. I'm extremely competitive. I think I'm semi-intelligent. And so I love competing at the highest level for the same thing. It's a full contact sport. Prepared to get the shit kicked out of you multiple times. Not physically, mentally. And, you know, if it all works out, you know, maybe in 5, 10, 15 years, you have an empire. So that's what I think.
Question six here, being along, you know, where you are in your journey, how much time do you work in your business as opposed to on your business on a daily basis?
I would say I'm probably 40% in my business and 60% on my business. They're both very important. So if you're the operator of your company, call it what you want, you're the owner, principal, CEO, president, there's a lot of names, a lot of titles for people that like titles. I don't really care. You can call me the janitor. Titles are not important to me whatsoever. But it's very important that you know your business and understand your business and know what's going on inside of your business, or someone else is going to. And 9 times out of 10, when someone else knows your business and you don't, they're going to take it. Or they're going to take a piece of it, or they're going to take the money. So you need to understand what's going on in your business at all times. So either you need to be the operator, the operations guy, and you need to be fully involved in that. But at some point, you're going to get to a place of scalability where that's not possible. So you hire something called a COO, Chief Operating Officer, and you have to trust that guy with your life because he's feeding you all the data of what's going on in your day-to-day operations. So he's basically telling you when your heart's beating and, you know, when you're allowed to shower and go to the bathroom. And, you know, if his word isn't gold, he can run you astray very quickly and your company can start to go sideways. Now, if you have a really, really good COO, he'll take 80% of the bullshit off your plate. And so it allows you to concentrate on more revenue generation, so increasing revenue, M&A activity if you're into mergers and acquisitions or you're into expansion, new business endeavors and generation there as well, which kind of goes back into M&A. And then, you know, you're the face of the company, so you need to be out there shaking hands, kissing babies, making sure that, you know, the general public looks very highly, thinks very highly of you as well as your company. And it's called the face guy. You're the face guy, you know. You're out there. When everyone sees your face, they think of your company. So you have to be a great example and lead by example, not only to the public, to the outside, but also internally, because the entire company is going to be looking up to you as their leader, as their chief commander. And so you need to set a good example for everyone. You know, I'll give you some examples. I've built and ran very large companies, up to 500 employees at times. And, you know, I would get there very early to the office, you know, 7:15, 7:30. And I would pick up trash in the parking lot. That's what I would do. If there's trash, I'd pick it up. I don't want my places looking like shit. And I take pride in what I have. So I want it to look the best that it can look. And as people were coming to work, they'd see the CEO of the company picking up trash in the parking lot. What kind of precedent do you think that sets for the company? Basically, what I'm instilling in everyone is, guys, I don't ask you to do anything I won't do. I'm not going to ask you to go bungee jump without a bungee. Because I wouldn't do that. But if I ask you to go pick up trash in the parking lot, I hope that you go do it because that's what I do every morning. I don't mind. I'm not above anything. We're all equals here. I take out my own trash out of my office. I don't need someone, janitor, to take it out in the middle of the night. I can do these things. And sometimes I like mundane tasks. They're mindless and they're a bit of zen sometimes when you're going through high intense situations in business. Like, sometimes you just need your brain just needs a break, and so you just want to go do something mindless. Like, household chores can be fun sometimes. I hate to say it, but it's true. So, that's my thoughts on that. And do we have any more questions?
Actually, one more. So, okay. You know, based on your experience of building and scaling, you know, multiple companies, you know, what was some of the most important leadership skills that, you know, you feel you had to learn? And you think, you know, people who want to build a successful business should learn?
I mean, you can Google, you know, all the characteristics of a good leader. Things that I do personally is I think I hit on one. I'll never ask you to do anything I wouldn't do myself. We're all equals, you know, here. I'm not some high power superhuman or anything like that. I'm just another person just like all of you. I think that goes a long way with people humanizing yourself. I'm very collaborative, so I'm the boss and you're the worker, so, you know, shut the hell up and listen to me. I'm more of, and maybe it's probably the millennial in me, is, hey, guys, let's get all the brightest minds in a room around a table, and let's collaborate, and no egos here. Whoever has the best idea wins, and let's run with it. You know, I'm not trying to be the man all the time. I don't need that. I'm all about, let's find out who has the best idea, and let's execute on that. I always lead by example. Honesty is very important to me. Integrity is very important to me. Doing whatever it takes to get the job done is very important to me. I'm not a victim. I don't claim to be a victim. I'm a self-starter, and I can't handle the victim card. So those are just the things I ask from people in return, and you know, I'll give them the same thing. I always have an open-door policy at my companies, so anyone can come to my office and talk to me about anything. I'm not above, you know, oh, you can't come to my office. You only sweep the floors. Like, no, you're still a human being. You're still a person. You have feelings. You're an entry level, but you're working your way up, and, you know, hopefully I can help you become very successful over time. So, and people see this stuff, you know, and historically it's built very, very strong cultures inside of my company, and culture's one of the biggest things you can have for an extremely successful company. If you have hundreds of people rowing in the same direction and excited to do so, you can create something very special that might even exceed any expectation you ever had. So just keep these things in mind, guys. You know, try to apply them in your daily lives and business if you're working on businesses. And keep sending the questions in, because I think it's very important that we start to answer things that are on your guys' mind and what you're thinking of when you're hearing kind of our dialogue and what we're going through on a regular basis. So I love answering questions and trying to interact with you guys as much as possible. And I can't encourage you guys enough to, you know, to get out there and throw some questions. And then the other thing is just taking some of the stuff we give you guys and try to apply it and execute. And, you know, I'd love to hear some of your guys' success stories that you've gained by utilizing different things that we've talked about on this podcast. So, again, guys, I appreciate you tuning in, and excited to catch up with y'all next week. So until then, boys and girls, catch soon.
20 pack in a black bag, 100 grand in my backpack. Yeah, we get real trap money, fuck a rap check, dog. I don't ever wanna be broke again. I take two big puffs and I hold it in. I'm on the Golden Gate Bridge on my way to Moran. I've been in the game, I just pray that I win.